Good morning. Welcome to Bethel. Would you please stand? Let's sing together.
Joy of my soul, you are.
Please be seated. Good morning. Welcome to Bethel. We are so excited to worship and praise with you this morning. We've got a few announcements, starting with a reminder or a Camp Lael run walk next week, right? Next Saturday? Saturday, September 14th, up at Camp Lael. It is their annual run walk fundraiser that they do to help raise funds to offset the cost of camp and attendance and all of the things that they do up there. You can run, you can walk, you can support our runners and walkers, or you can go up and also support them on site. It should be a very special day. And so if anything, just pray for the day. And there is a sign-up sheet for donations in the narthex. So you can support our runners if you'd like. We just started our new Bible study this week. It is Mission Possible with Tim Tebow, and so it's a great time to jump in and start or join us on this journey through this new study. It should be very interesting as we talk about what our mission is and how God makes our missions possible and how we are equipped and what he will teach us over the coming weeks as we study this one. It is youth group time. Youth group at Bethel Baptist is open to 6th graders through 12th graders, and they meet pretty much regularly on Sundays. You can see the schedule right there. But our first meeting is today at 6 p.m. here in the Ed Building. Yes, next door. Next door they meet. This is Cal's first year, so I get to learn all these things. And then we have a special event coming up on September 22nd. There'll be more information about that. But mark your calendars, and if you're in 6th through 12th grade, you are invited and welcome, and we'd love to have you here. Bring a friend, bring two, bring three. But it's a great time for our kids to spend some time fellowshipping together. Summer is coming to an end, or has come to an end. We're back in school, and so we're back to our monthly game nights, our first one of the fall being September 20th. That'll be downstairs in the fellowship hall at 7 p.m., so that's a week from this Friday. And so mark your calendars, come. They'll play all kinds of interesting games. There's snacks, there's drinks. It's just a great time. So a nice family time. Come here and come downstairs and join us. And then that Sunday, September 22nd, Mike Williams will be here. Many of you may remember he was here last year and did a comedy show, which was fantastic. And he happens to be coming through town and asked if he could stop and share a word with us. So next Sunday during the 22nd during our sermon time, Mike Williams will be here and he will share our message and about his ministry. And it should be a really great time. So mark your calendars to be here that Sunday and be a part of that special service. And then another reminder of our hayride coming up on October 19th out at Real Life Farms. It's a great time of fellowship. We share a meal together. We get to have a little hayride. There's all kinds of cute animals. So it's a fun time. If you have transportation issues or if the cost is an issue, just let the church know and we'll figure out a way to make sure that everyone who wants to be there can be there. And then a reminder of registration books in our pews. You'll see those in the end of the pews. Make sure you fill those out so we know who was here today. And lastly, just a note to share. Many of you know Carnell Richardson. He has preached here for years and years. And today he is being installed this afternoon officially at his new church, Metropolitan Memorial, out in Ipsy. So we're praising God for that and praying for our dear friend Carnell. And just keep Carnell and his family in your thoughts today as they are installed at that church. And with that, please stand for our scripture.
Our scripture today comes from the book of Ephesians, chapter 4, verse 32. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ has also forgiven you.
We are one in the Spirit. We are one. Be
you pray with me? Lord God, thank you for your love. While we were sinners and broken and didn't deserve us, you sent Jesus to save us. And it was his love, your love, that held him to the cross. And we are so thankful. We pray today that you would fill our hearts, you would open our mind and our ears to what you would have for us to hear, heal what needs to be healed, and be with us as we worship and praise you. God, we pray that our service is anointed and pleases you, and that we would pour forth from this building today filled with your Holy Spirit. In your name we pray, amen.
Be my guide, be my
As we come to our time of offering and our ushers come forward, we remind you that you can support the ministry of Bethel Baptist here in the church, or through our website or by mailing in a donation.
Can't count the times I've called your name some broken night. And you showed up and patched me up like you do every time. I get amnesia. I forget that you keep coming around. Yeah, ain't no way you'll ever let me down. Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes. 'Cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs. Tell me, is he good? He's good. Tell me, is he God? He's God. He is good God Almighty. You say your love goes on forever and your mercy never stops. So why would I assume you'd be somebody that you're not? Like the sun in the morning, I know you're gonna be here every day. So what on earth could make me be afraid? Jesus in the morning, Jesus in the noontime, Jesus when the sun goes down.
Please stand as our ushers come forward. Linda Gardner will pray for our offering this morning.
Dear God Almighty, please accept these gifts that we are giving back at this time from the abundance that you have provided for each of us. Let us show the world, let us show the neighborhood that Jesus is King, that he is God Almighty, and that this church worships him. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Please be seated.
Kids may gather up here. Mandy's going to take you across the way. Oh, well, before you leave, we're going to pray, especially for you two. We're going to pray for our students and teachers. I'm not saying we're not going to pray for Joy. I just don't want Mandy to leave because she's a teacher. We're praying for teachers and students. So if you're a teacher or a student, please stand. And not a student of life, an actual enrolled student, okay? If you're a student of life, that makes all of us, right? So So we are. We want to pray for you right now, and you get to keep standing because you're still in school. Yeah, that's right. It doesn't feel like it, but it is. You're still in. So we want to lift them up, lift up our teachers, our students, not just you here, all over our country and the world. Lift them up as we try to move forward, an anointing blessing upon you to learn and anointing blessing upon the teachers for compassion, kindness, and you know everything else that you need. So let us bow our heads and pray for them. Lord, we pray for all the students here that you give them a thirsting heart for knowledge, not just of you, but for everything. And we pray, Lord, for our teachers that you not only keep them safe, but you give them the joy that is in you, because this is, they're doing your job in the students' lives. Education was started in this country so that people could read the Bible. And we pray that the education continue and that you continually turn our teachers towards you and towards ways of loving their students. We pray all these things in Jesus' name, and everyone said, Amen. All right. Let's take another moment or two, even though it encourages us to pray more, to share with one another good things that may be going on in our lives now and or prayer concerns that you have. I know Don Slangster has been moved to a rehab place. I think it's still within the hospital, but he is going through rehab now, so that is good news. And Art Villanueva, who we've been praying for, he is out of the hospital and at home recovering. That is a miracle, especially those of us that visited him just a couple weeks ago in the hospital. So we are praising God for Art coming home. How else can we pray for you?
I'd like to pray for my son-in-law, Tim. There are very, very serious concerns about him and my granddaughter.
Okay. Well, let the people online who are watching know that we pray for you. Anna, Jeannie, we're praying for you. I don't know others by name, but I know that you two watch almost every week, so we pray for you once we know that you're your name. So if you're online, let us know you're there with a praise or with a prayer so that we can pray for you during the week.
Praying for Pam Bellis and her shoulder surgery recovery.
She has shoulder surgery recovery. We're praying for her. We're praising God for the sounds of babies in this place.
Amen. We started talking this week at school about clinical placements, what hospital I'm going to do my clinical in. The whole thing is very stressful to me. So just prayers that God puts me where he wants me and that I listen to him.
Okay. The listening part, I know that's where you're going to struggle. I'm going to pray really hard for that. John.
Next Saturday is my birthday.
Oh, right.
And I ask anybody that's not going to make it to the camp layout, we have Diana here is in a Christian art exhibit. This next Saturday. So
oh, she is.
Anybody that can't make it to Camp Layout, maybe you can make it out to Livonia.
Okay. All right. We do have Camp Layout. Is that coming up this Saturday? So we have some people who are running or walking very slowly, raising money to do a 5K there. And after the 5K, we are going to do some baptisms. So we want to pray that all of that goes smoothly because one of them's not here because she's under the weather a little bit. So we want to pray for them, make sure everyone's all healthy for that. One last prayer request over there. Is that why you're there? No. All right, let's bow our heads and pray. Lord, we're so grateful for all you're doing in the church, bringing people home from the hospital, answering our prayers just as we have asked them. And Lord, I am thrilled by this. And we ask you, Lord, to hear all the things that we've shared here today, but to bless all the things that are going on in our church, to bless us and open our hearts and minds to your word as we examine it here today. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. We are still looking at the early church. And we are looking at the fruits of the Spirit. In Acts 2, the early church would have exhibited the fruits of the Spirit. And today we look at the fruit of the Spirit, which is called kindness. Kindness. Proverbs 19:20. What is desirable in a man or a woman is his or her kindness. And it is better to be poor than a liar. Fruit of the Spirit, kindness. We said last week that to be more patient, one of the things you can do is to practice kindness, and that helps your patience. But what is kindness? What is the opposite of kindness? And how can I help myself be more kind? Before we get into all of that, I want to just a little warning. The world will cry out to you, you're not being kind. I've heard that many, many times. You're not being kind. Sometimes they don't use the word kind. It's a little more flavorful. We are not to be kind at the world's bidding. We're to be kind at God's bidding. We're to be kind following the Holy Spirit. That's what we're supposed to be doing. I'll explain this as we go along. So what is kindness according to Scripture? I'm going to go with this definition. Kindness is showing merciful, compassionate selflessness. Kindness is showing merciful, compassionate selflessness. This is the word from Hebrew that we translate into kindness, or from the Greek. Christianity is not necessarily spread on the power of its preaching. I know God's word goes out, and it never goes out void. It always has an effect. Amen? But I don't think that the world changed in the Roman times because of the preaching. I don't think that's what changed people. And I don't think it was because of the worship. People are moved during worship. We're filled with the Spirit during worship. But I'm not sure that was the thing in the early church that changed the world. Lives are changed in the world by a demonstration of love in a person's life. Demonstration of love in a person's life. In a way, that is kindness. Kindness is that love. It is that demonstration to somebody else that God cares, that God is in their life. When Jesus died on the cross, he did that out of kindness. When God pours his mercy out upon us, that's done in kindness. And that's not all those things are, but that's partly that. We are called as a church, as people, to love all people, be kind to all the people in the world, just as Jesus was kind. Now, we have to weigh in a little bit of theology here. I want to emphasize kindness is not a requirement for salvation. All right? But listen to these words in Matthew 25. Then he will also say to those on his left, depart from me, accursed ones, into the eternal fire which has been prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. Naked, and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. When we look at this passage, I know that to be saved, all I need to do is call upon the name of Jesus, right? That's all I need to do. When we look at this passage, it seems to say that there's something required. Because he's sending them away for the things they did not do. If you don't do these things, you will not get into heaven, is what Scripture is saying. So how do we reconcile these things that these people did not do and the fact that all you have to do is call upon Jesus as salvation? Is this a contradiction in Scripture? I'm sure you're all going to be surprised when I say no. Ooh, no one's looking surprised. It isn't a contradiction. I will explain. Here's how we say it in theology circles. We don't say it this way because we use, 12-syllable words, but we say it something along these lines. If you're not doing acts of kindness, you probably aren't saved. Or if I can put it the reverse way, a person who is saved will perform acts of kindness. There's something after we accept Jesus that changes us, that helps us do this into the world. It makes us more kind. It's a sign of something going on in our heart. That's what the kindness is. And I'm going to add this. We are to be kind even when we don't feel like being kind. With a couple of warnings, all right? Let me explain this by sharing with you a story. I had a friend who I hadn't seen in some years, and we met up, and he asked me for money while I was still at college at Michigan. He asked me for money because he was having a run of bad luck, which was obvious. His leg was in a cast. He was on crutches. And at the time, as a poor college student, my answer was, "You're not getting any of my money." I rarely actually saw money when I was at Michigan. I mean, you know, I'd forgotten who was on the $50 bill or the $20 bill. I'd never seen one of those when I was at college. So I wasn't going to give him his money. But later, when I left him, I felt bad. And I thought, oh, man, he's down on his luck. He needs food. He's asking me for food. And I felt convicted. So I went out and I bought some food. And I went over to his apartment and I said and knocked on his door. And he answers the door and says, "What's this?" And I says, "Well, I felt bad about saying no to you, about giving you money for food. So here it is. I brought you some food." And he goes, "I don't want that food. I want you to give me money so I can pick out my own food." That's when I realized he didn't want food. Right? When we're to be kind to people, we have to be discerning. Because sometimes the kindness that people want isn't the kindness we should be showing them. Kindness comes in all sorts of different forms. This is our dilemma. We're called to help people. Sometimes that means we have to be discerning and wise in how we give them help. We have to make sure God is part of the equation so we can help them in the best way that we can. We are to use our head in helping people. That means sometimes we act fast, and that means sometimes we act slow. Now, kindness. Save person perform acts of kindness. Kindness. We are to be kind with both words and actions. We are to be kind with both our words and our actions. With a food pantry, we give food to anybody who asks without questioning their lives at all. You say you need it, we give out food. When I help out of the food pantry, which is, you know, rare upstairs, but, you know, when I do it, I try to combine food with kind words, because sometimes the people coming through the line, they have not heard a kind word in a long, long time. They've been down and out, down on their luck. Things are not going well for them. And and when that starts happening to people, you know, everything becomes harder. And so I try, especially when I'm leaving the office and people are stand up outside waiting to come into the food pantry, I try to come in and say some kind words and share kind words with those people who are waiting and give them encouragement. We are to have these kinds of words and actions even if we don't feel like giving them. God's kindness, as a note, God's kindness often goes out without a thank you. We know that. God does kind things in our lives, and we may forget to thank him when it happens. So our next point is, don't expect people to thank you for helping them. When you're kind to them, when you help them, don't expect to thank you. When it comes, praise God. Accept it. Be joyful. But don't expect it, because it may not come. That is not what we do the kindness for. We don't do kindness, that is. We're not kind to people because they're going to thank us for it. We're kind to people because God commands us to be kind to people. And then we're not to take credit for the kindness we show. We're not to take credit. That's right. The kindness we show should be the kindness that comes from our heart that God has put there. We show the kindness that God has given us. It should be the Holy Spirit working through us. We are not to show the world our kindness, but God's mercy, his love, and his kindness. Any good I've done in my life is done because God's Holy Spirit has moved in me. It's not my spirit that's done it. It's God's spirit working through me. The opposite of kindness. You might think it's meanness, but it's not. The opposite of kindness is selfishness. The opposite of kindness is selfishness. Kindness in words and deed mean we share what we have with others. We share our joy, we share our sorrows, we share our resources, we share our strength, and when we withhold it, that's selfishness. God has given us these things so that we can share them with one another. Why do people withhold kindness in the world? Someone comes up and says something. You go up to someone and you say something, and instead of a kind word, you get a mean response or a rebuke, or they get angry, or sometimes they stop speaking to you altogether. Have you ever had that? And you think, well, I was just trying to be kind. Why do people withhold kindness? People withhold kindness for a few reasons. One is they or you or me might be sitting in judgment. I withhold kindness because I'm judging that other person. The Pharisees in Jesus' time and the Pharisees in our time will look at people who ask for food and say, get a job, you bum, right? It's like a cliche. They're sitting in judgment of that other person. But the fact is, they don't know why that person is asking for food. They don't know the journey that that person has gone from. And it's not our job when they're asking for food, when they're asking for some of these things, to judge them for that. God wants to reserve that judgment for himself. We are to show kindness to them when they are in trouble. The Pharisees in our day look down upon those people. We are not to do that. We're to remember that most of us in this room are one stock market crash away from being homeless. I mean, that's true. I mean, when 29 hit, there were so many people that thought, I'm immune to all of this. I've got all of this money and all this property and all that, and lose it all in a matter of months. And they find themselves out on the street. Sometimes we withhold kindness because we're judging. Sometimes we withhold kindness because we feel our resources are exhausted or low. Bible does not say, give till it hurts. Doesn't say that. But did Jesus give till it hurts? Oh, yes. He gave everything he was. He put himself on that cross out of kindness. You can't say he didn't give till it hurts. He gave beyond. We're to give, even out of our scarcity. We're to share out of our abundance, yes. But we're also to sacrifice out of our scarcity with people. You know, Bill Gates, if he gave $10 million to our church tomorrow, which I hope he does. If you're listening, Bill, we would accept the money. But if he, you know, that's like, you know, that's not even money out of his change purse, right? That's just, oh, yeah, here, you know, that's a tip for him, right? You know, there are people in this church, there are people that I've known that have given money to the church and then have gone hungry till their next paycheck. We know that this happens. We're to give out of abundance and out of scarcity. We're to be kind at all times. We're not to think of our own well-being, but only the movement of the Holy Spirit. Sometimes we withhold our kindness because we're in a bad mood. Sometimes we do that. Something happens, someone says something, and you know, the clouds gather over your head. You know, in those times, I just go off by myself so that I don't share the clouds. I just go off and try to be dark and sad or mad all by myself. That's what I try to do. But we're in those moments, those are moments we withhold kindness. I don't want you to hear that when we do this kindness thing that we're to be kind. We are to be kind at all times. You might hear that I'm to pretend to be kind. I'm not saying that we should pretend. There's something else. There's another route that we're supposed to shade. We're not to pretend. We're not to fake things in order to fulfill Scripture. But we are sometimes to put our feelings aside and help people, whether we feel it or not. Do you hear what I'm saying? We're to put those things aside, even though we are afraid or mad or something. When we do that, when I have done that, even in a bad mood, even if I'm afraid because of scarcity, even when I'm in those dark places, and I do an act of kindness, I find my heart changes. God does something in me in those moments. And whatever it was that was affecting me, it disappears, it changes. It opens my eyes or softens my heart or clears my head. It changes me to do the act of kindness. Christians are to be marked by kindness in the world, marked by our words and our deeds. We're not to withhold kindness because we're in a bad mood or because people don't deserve help, because we remember Jesus saved us when we didn't deserve it. So we don't sit in judgment like that. Our kindness is to be a radical extravagance. We are to be radicals in kindness. Our kindness in word and deed is to be such that both liberals and conservatives are shocked by it. This church is no stranger to helping people. In a lot of ways, I look out over your faces, I feel like I'm preaching to the choir. You know, what that meant used to mean, for those of you who don't know, it's you're telling people to do something they're already doing. And in a lot of ways, this church is great at showing kindness to people. We are no stranger to helping people. There are several spheres, though, that we can show kindness, right? The easy one is based on people's physical needs. Showing kindness, fulfilling their physical needs, food, housing, transportation, medical attention. We do that. Could we do more? Well, maybe. We do that, though, as a church. This sphere is the place where the world really can see how Christians are different. They can see Christians showing God's love, right? But there's another sphere we might call spiritual care, meeting the needs of people spiritually. Every person on earth needs to know Jesus. Amen? Otherwise, you know, when you come to the end of the life, you're in a bit of trouble. That's what we believe. That's what we stake our lives on. That's what Christians have died for, is that idea, is that other people need to hear who Jesus is, or when they come to judgment day, they will be in trouble. We're trying to save them from that trouble. We have to meet that spiritual need. We have to bring people along that spiritual road. And a lot of times when we take a look at this, the problem with people is that they think that their biggest problem is food, and it's not. It's the lack of Jesus. Because even when I fulfill my needs for food and my body and everything, at some point, my body's going to give out and die. And I'm going to be smack up on that judgment day. And what am I going to say then without Jesus? That's a more important thing. This life is temporary. We're trying to save people for eternity. So in a lot of ways, we do really well in this physical sphere, but are we doing as well in sharing the gospel with people? In meeting that spiritual need, when they come to the point of anxiousness, when they come to the point of fear, when they come to the point where they're sick and looking at death, do we answer that need? When I discard this body, that's when I most have to be most concerned about what's going to happen. And then the last sphere, the needs of the world. We are not just supposed to meet the physical needs of people and their spiritual needs. We are to meet the needs of God's creation. Genesis 2:15, Adam and Eve were set here on earth to take care of the earth. That was their job. It says in Scripture they're to take care of Eden. But there's some theologians, including myself, that believe that their job was to take the little garden of Eden and spread it through the whole world. And the reason we say that is that when Jesus comes to redeem the world and creates a new heaven and new earth, that's what he's going to do. He's going to make the whole world Eden and not just one little part. When Adam and Eve died, that job, their job of taking care of the earth was passed down to us. We're to take care of the earth. When we take care of creation, there are a lot of you that know this, right? It fulfills a need somewhere. We're blessed by it. We may not understand it, but we know When we take a walk through the woods or sit on the beach or just breathe deeply after a freshly fallen rain, there are moments when we just say, this is right. I feel God. I feel His Spirit moving. That's His kindness. So our kindness doesn't end at our neighbor or our neighbor's physical needs. It transcends all of creation. Now, I know some of you may be thinking, Pastor Paul, I mean, sometimes these things are in conflict. Sometimes these things, you know, are in order. You feel pulled by one to another. How are we to choose which one we're supposed to do? How are we supposed to decide how to, which one of these needs to fulfill in any kind of given moment? And I'm going to give you a really easy way to decide to make this choice. What's in front of you right now today? Who is standing in front of you right now? The waitress? Your family? The doctor? Who is standing in front of you? Meet that need. Spiritual, physical, or the world. What's in front of you right now? Our kindness doesn't end. So how do I create more kindness in my life? Kindness is an action. You create more kindness by doing kindness. When you do it, you change. Your life changes. It's done one day at a time, one step at a time. A grateful Christian should show kindness as a matter of spiritual growth. But if you're struggling with it and you want more kindness in your life, find a person who has a need and fill it. And then tell people what you've done. And here's why you do that. Studies show that when you meet someone and you fulfill their need, they feel better. Are you surprised? Whew, amazing. But studies also show that when you do that, you feel better. You're changed. And then when you tell someone else what you've done for that other person, the third person feels better just hearing about what you've done. And then studies show that both the person whose need you felt and the person whom you've told will go out and be more kind. So kindness is infectious. You can spread it. You can spread it by doing it and spread it by telling people what you're doing. It builds people up. Scripture says, don't put your light under a basket. Set it up on the light stand so that the whole world can see it. This is a call from Jesus. So if you're struggling, help someone. Don't forget their spiritual needs are actually more important, even though that when they're hungry, they can't see that themselves. So we have a food pantry here. There are people in church that need hospital visits. I can't tell you how many hospital visits I've done in the past month. A lot. I'm going to try to ask you people to get less sick, but I know we don't have control over that, right? And I am happy to visit anybody in the hospital. If you know someone who needs a pastor's visit in the hospital or sick at home, you call and tell me, because I can't be aware of everything that's going on all the time. And then sometimes someone shares, I forget. I don't want to forget. So please help me there. But also, we can do that. There are people in the church who need visits, need rides to places, need housing, need jobs to do, because being useful is a need people have. Just look at who's in front of you now, and then be kind. As we close our service, I invite our singers to come forward to close us in the last song. If you have need of prayer for anything, we are doing baptisms at Lael on Saturday. If you want to be a part of that, come to Lael and be baptized in the lake, come forward. And if you want to join the church, we ask you also to come forward. Would you please stand as we close our service in song?
Make me
Now may the Lord of mercy and grace give you the power to be kind to everyone you meet and show the gospel wherever you go. We pray these things in Jesus' name, and everyone said,
Amen. Amen.